Welcome back to Morning Joe. Joe and I back with John Meacham, Richard Wolff, Jonathan Capehart, and joining us now, senior editor of The Atlantic, Richard Florida. He's the author of The Rise of the Creative Class, now in its 10th anniversary edition. And we're back at the table to talk about that. Michael Steele, by the way, still with us from Washington as well. All right, very good to have you on the show.
Thank you. It's great to be with you guys.
Give us a sense of revisiting The Rise of the Creative Class and some of the challenges that we face trying to break through.
Well, it's been a great 10-year run, not just for Rise of the Creative Class, but for cities. You know, when I wrote the book, it was seen as quite controversial that young people or gay people or artistic people would be key to rebuilding cities, and people argued a lot about that. But over the past decade, cities are back. 50% of the world's population now lives in cities, and increasingly, economists know, and even economists know, and policymakers know, that if we want to grow the economy, we have to invest in skills, we have to invest in technology, we have to invest in our cities. So, and mayors all over the country are getting it, too.
You went right to cities. Let's go to the top creative U.S. cities, starting at number one, Boulder, Colorado.
Well, it's interesting. You know, natural resource towns have done well in the crisis, but college towns have just been kicking it, you know? And not just Boulder.
Is that a technical sociological
term? You look at the top towns.
Yes,
it's San Francisco. It's Seattle. It's Boston. But the Boulders, the Corvallis, a place like Gainesville. And what was very positive for me, my wife is from Detroit. We just did a video series on rebuilding Detroit. To see Ann Arbor come in tied for fourth as one of the nation's most creative cities shows that it is possible to rebuild our Rust Belt, and I think that's good news.
Very nice. Go ahead, John.
So what goes into, you know, making Boulder number one, San Francisco number two? You know, as it's still a diehard New Yorker, I'm surprised that New York isn't on there, because New Yorkers think they're the most creative people in the world.
New York does great on our indexes, and it's obviously it is the greatest global city in the world, and the mayor here and the city has really turned around since, I mean, I grew up in Newark, so I've watched this city turn around over the past 50 years or so. What goes into it is we rate cities on three T's. Technology, are you a technology leader? Do you have a great research university, great tech companies? Talent, do you have the skills, the capability, the human capital? And then the third one, which sometimes gets controversial, are you a tolerant place that's open to everyone? Mm-hmm. Where women and men, gay and straight, all ethnicities and nationalities, and one of the things that's been a big topic you guys discuss is we need this country, keep this country open to immigration. 50% of those Silicon Valley high-tech businesses are college towns in the New Ellis Islands. 50% of those Silicon Valley businesses were started by a foreign-born person. So that's what really powers economic growth. So it's three T's: technology, talent, tolerance.
I want to get to the cities abroad, but first, Joe, jump in. I think I know what you're going to say.
Well, yeah, of course. You know what I'm going to say. Where's Tuscaloosa, Alabama?
Exactly.
But most importantly, I don't see Pensacola. I don't see Fort Walton. I don't see Panama City.
Where's
Beach?
McLean?
None of the Redneck Riviera. Where? Well, McLean. I mean, come on. Seriously. Looks like a town where a bunch of hippies hang out and smoke pot or something.
You sound like the way Colbert grilled me one day. It's great to see you, Joe. And you know that I visited Pensacola a number of times and work with them on making their city and help with that institute and everything they're doing down there.
Right.
And they're doing good. Florida's doing better, but Florida has openness. It has visitors. I spend the winter in Miami, but it's got to invest a little bit more in that technology. It's got to bring bigger skills. Mm-hmm. And as for Alabama, Huntsville does terrifically. It may not be Tuscaloosa, but I'll tell you, Huntsville is really a place hidden off the agenda that is doing terrifically around technology and research and growing its economy.
And you know, Mika, college towns also have a chance to really explode over the next 10, 20, 30 years if we finally crack the code on an alternative energy source that's cheap enough and economical enough that we can produce it on scale and run the economy. You will see smaller college towns, just like Richard's talking about, absolutely explode. Instead of some oil patches in Texas or Saudi Arabia or some natural gas fields in Pennsylvania, you will actually have smaller college towns across America. Research with the patents, with the money flooding in from all across the world.
Don't disagree. Michael Steele wants to jump into the conversation. Michael.
I do. Richard, I found this work very interesting. And my question, you know, really goes to is, do you see this whole idea of being creative as elitist? And even from how about gentrification? Does this connote some type of gentrification? When I look at my hometown of Washington, D.C., which was once known as Chocolate City, is now more mocha on its way to vanilla.
So,
cafe au lait. But what happens in these urban centers? How do they fit into this creative process?
Well, I'll tell you, over the past 10 years, there's been a great debate on this from both the right and the left and critics, and a great conversation. First of all, I open the book by saying every single human being is creative, and the key to turning this country around is to stoke that creative furnace in everyone. And what makes, I think, America great and American cities great is the creativity doesn't come from the top. You know, that's the big mistake. The smartest kids I ever met were the kids back home in Newark, New Jersey, and North Arlington, New Jersey. They were smarter than the kids that I went to school with at MIT or Columbia or I teach at university. So America's been very good at pumping this up from the bottom. But the gentrification debate is a serious one. And obviously, I lived in D.C. a long time, and I'm a big fan of go-go. I hope you're a big fan of go-go music,
yes.
too. I love go-go music.
Yes.
But one of the things we've seen is people get priced out. Now, the research suggests that even with gentrification, people in gentrifying neighborhoods, on balance, this isn't always the case, are better off. But my mentor was a lady named Jane Jacobs, and I think she had the best one-liner on this I've ever heard. She said, when a place gets boring, even the rich people leave. So when a place gets too homogeneous and too boring and that artistic and creative vibe gets soaked out, it starts to go into the cycle of decline.
I want to get to the cities abroad, but first, Richard Wolff.
Yeah, you know, and national politics, whether it's for cultural reasons or electoral strategy, still seems to value small towns, rural America. That's what the iconography of campaigning is like. Do you see national politicians talking about these urban issues, whether on the creative side or the perennial inner city issues? Is anyone addressing this at the national level?
No, the mayors get it. And it's not a right-left cut on that. It's not a red-blue cut. The mayors, I write in the book, if actually Joe will like this, it comes from my visit to Pensacola. I sat at the table.
There you go.
People were talking about national politics and ripping each other's eyes out.
Exactly.
The mayors were there, right? I couldn't tell who was a Democrat, who was a Republican.
The mayor's pretty. Me. I'm just telling you, the mayor of Pensacola is
nice.
Pretty.
That's a good thing.
He likes to look in the mirror, and he's got very white teeth.
It,
John Meacham, you're next.
Please.
As Joe knows, the key to Huntsville, Alabama, is its proximity to Sewanee, Tennessee. That's kind of the spillover effect. But I wanted to ask you about, we had big news this week about San Bernardino, a lot of bankruptcies. How are you feeling about the capacity of local leadership to handle crisis that's coming to
the cities of sand, the cities that didn't build on their creativity, that didn't build on their skills, that thought they could build an economy off housing, flipping housing. It just didn't work. Phoenix, San Bernardino. I think local leadership in this country is pretty good, but there's still gaps. And just going back to the previous point, we need new urban policy. We tend to view our cities as basket cases that need help and they're poor. We need a policy that views cities as a core,
right,
along with technology and innovation and education, views cities and our urban areas as the drivers of our economic prosperity.
So let's close on the top creative cities abroad, Amsterdam, Stockholm. I couldn't agree with you more. It was just there. It was amazing. Helsinki, Oxford, and Munich. Wow.
And Toronto's in there. You know, we spent part of the year, I split my time between the University of Toronto and now NYU. You can see, I wrote this a long time ago in the Washington Monthly. The U.S. big competition isn't necessarily coming from China and India. It is. That's for lower wage. The big competition for talent is coming from cities like London. Mayor Bloomberg realizes this, and he's made this city better. But the Torontos, the Sydneys, the places in Northern Europe that are growing their creative economy, that are wealthier. And, you know, one is Calgary. You talk about a place that's done oil and natural resources with education and skills. Calgary is now the richest community in North America.
The book is The Rise of the Creative Class, the 10-year anniversary edition. Richard Florida, thank you so much.